see your smiling faces. And nice to see people without masks on too. So we really can see your smiles. If you put death on a topic for an evening's presentation, you wonder if anybody's gonna show up. But the reality is, well, there's two. One is the time of the year. You know, the leaves are dropping like flies off the trees, as even in California, our summer turned to autumn and our autumn will turn to winter. Nothing as dramatic as Toledo, but you know, still we feel seasonal changes. And then the month of November coming up, October 31st, All Hallows Eve, Halloween, and then All Saints Day this coming Sunday and All Souls Day, Dias de los Muertos on November 2nd. So it's a good time to look at the end things, and others are doing the same as well. I'm going to begin with a passage from St. Francis de Sales, especially in terms of facing end times. He wrote, "We must try to preserve an evenness of temper amid so great an unevenness of events. And though all things around us change, we must strive to be unchanged with our eyes fixed on God above. Let everything be topsy-turvy, not only without us, but within. It matters not. Our will must be ever directed to the good pleasure of God, our only and sovereign God." So even in the face of death, he would recommend that evenness of temper amid the changing world around us. So this evening, I'm going to use the PowerPoint presentation for the first part of it. And so if Christoph will share the screen with me.
You are co-host, Father John, so you can actually go ahead and share your screen.
Thank you. And you tell me to make sure that you can see me.
Yes, we can see your slide.
Okay. Well, even our kids in the parish and their families are looking at these end times. This is one of the altars from this past Sunday's faith family experience. The families did their faith sharing instead of gathering in the grand hall, as they often do with 200 and 300 people, age level, all age levels with their parents. They each got a kind of a family kit, a packet of material and information to deal with at home. And this was one of the ofrendas, which is the altar of the dead. And you'll see within all the skulls, you'll see they have pictures of their beloved departed. So I wanted to begin with a little perspective on death, looking at it from, many years ago.
Crash Course Philosophy is brought to you by Squarespace. Squarespace, share your passion with the world.
What are you afraid of? Spiders, public speaking, the dentist, calculus?
What about death? How you feel about death has probably been shaped by your beliefs about whether or not there's an afterlife, and if there is, what it's like. The ancient Egyptians believed that at death, your heart would be weighed against a feather to determine if it was fit to enter the underworld. A heart heavy with misdeeds would be fed to a demon. Christians may envision Saint Peter waiting at the pearly gates to welcome you into heaven, unless your name doesn't make his list. Imagine not only being turned away from the coolest club in town, but banished to the eternal torments of hell. As we learned in our discussions about the philosophy of religion, when the stakes are eternal, it's only reasonable to get a little nervous about what's basically the ultimate final exam. But if it makes you feel any better, many philosophers have believed and still believe that death is nothing to fear. In 399 BCE, Socrates was sentenced to death for, among other things, refusing to acknowledge the official deities of Athens, radicalizing youth, and generally honking off the people in charge. But even when he faced his own imminent death, he remained calm and unafraid. He was a philosopher, after all, and fear was no match for his ability to argue. Socrates didn't think we could know if there's an afterlife or not, but he thought there were really only two possibilities. And as far as he was concerned, neither of them was anything to be afraid of. Here's his argument. Either death is a dreamless sleep, or death is a passage to another life. Dreamless sleeps are nice, not scary. Socrates said he could use the rest. And a passage to another life sounds good too, because he'll get to hang out with cool people from the past who have already died. Therefore, either way, death is nothing to fear. Socrates' idea of the afterlife was Hades, which he seems to have pictured as being a lot like Athens, except that no one had any physical bodies, only disembodied minds. And frankly, he thought that sounded awesome, because bodies can be a real pain. They just need to be fed and required rest. There's so much upkeep. So in the afterlife, Socrates imagined he'd get to have endless philosophical conversations and continue learning new things with the greatest thinkers of the past, and they wouldn't have to take a break to eat or sleep or pee. Now, Socrates recognized that although his favorite activity, philosophizing, didn't require a body, some things do, and if all your favorite pastimes are physical, you might find the afterlife disappointing. That's why Socrates recommended spending your life looking after your mind, cultivating that part of you that you'll get to keep forever, if there's an afterlife. If you do that, when the time comes for you to die, you'll actually see death as a benefit, because you won't be troubled by bodily things while your mind will be in top form. But what if there isn't an afterlife? What about that dreamless sleep that Socrates spoke about? Isn't total annihilation of the self, like, the scariest thing there is? Ancient Stoic philosopher Epicurus didn't think so. He lived about 100 years after Socrates and rejected belief in an afterlife altogether. Instead, he said, "We are just our bodies, and nothing more." But still, he didn't find death scary. Here's his argument. Death is the cessation of sensation. Good and evil only make sense in terms of sensation, so death is neither good nor evil. Epicurus was convinced that things are only evil or bad if they feel bad. And he did not mean only physical feelings. Anyone who's ever had a broken heart will tell you that it's a lot more painful and harder to heal than a broken leg. But a broken heart is still a sensation. You need a body to experience. So as a materialist, someone who believed that you equals your body, death just meant non-existence. And there was nothing scary about that because, well, there won't be any you to have feelings about not existing. Epicurus argued that fearing non-existence is not only stupid, but it gets in the way of enjoying life. You are alive and experiencing sensations now. So, he said, make those sensations as great as possible and don't worry about when those sensations are gonna stop. YOLO! To help you understand Epicurus and his attitudes about death a little better, let's head over to the Thought Bubble for some flash philosophy. Think about a hangover. If you haven't had one, imagine what they might be like. Hangovers aren't bad for you before you get one, right? In fact, the thing that comes before the hangover is often quite pleasant, what with the laughing and feeling uninhibited and working up the courage to talk to that cutie from your calculus class. No, the hangover is only bad while it's happening. And true, it might be bad after it's over, like if it kept you from doing well in the calculus exam the next morning because you were too busy trying not to barf in front of said cutie. But the point is, if something is bad for you, it's generally bad for you at a particular time, the way a hangover is. But Epicurus said that death can't be bad for you at any time, because once it arrives, you're gone. The thing that eventually kills you, yeah, that's gonna be bad for you before your death. But that's not death. When you think about it, you and death are never present at the same time. And if there's no you when death is present, then there is no time in which death is bad for you. Thanks, Thought Bubble. So things like hangovers and Charlie horses and movie spoilers are bad because you're there to experience them. But as far as Epicurus was concerned, life was like a night of drinking before the hangover that is death, which, inevitable as it is, you will never actually experience. Now, the 21st century has its own perspectives on death, and one might be best described as a kind of philosophical FOMO. Contemporary American philosopher Thomas Nagel points out that some people dread death because they'll miss out on things that they want to experience. If you died right now, you'd never get to finish that video game you're in the middle of, or read the next George R. R. Martin book, or see humans land on Mars. Which would suck, yeah. But think about it like this. Cool stuff was going on way before you were born, and you missed it. I'm gonna make some assumptions about your age here and say that you weren't listening when Orson Welles terrified the nation with the War of the Worlds. You didn't march on Washington. You totally missed Woodstock. So Nagel asks, if you don't feel some sort of deep sense of loss at what you missed before you were even alive, why should you feel loss at what you'll miss after you die? Now, Nagel does point out that if we believe that life is essentially good, then there is something to mourn when a life is cut short. Since humans can live on average for about 80 years, someone dying at the age of 20 is a tragedy because that person missed missed out on 60 possible years of good times. But we should pause here to talk about what you really value about life, because that will also have an impact on what you think about death in general, or about the death of a particular person. If you say that life is just always inherently good, then you're said to place a high value on the sanctity of life. It doesn't matter what the content of that life looks like, or what the person is like, the fact that they're alive is just good. So losing it would not be good. But if you think that quality of life is what's important, then you're gonna want to distinguish between lives that are full of good experiences and those that aren't. If you value quality of life, you don't think that there's something inherently valuable about merely being alive. So in these terms, some deaths might actually be positive or valuable, like if they bring about an end to a terrible, painful existence. Now, of course, it might make sense to be afraid of dying itself, because the process of dying can be painful and drawn out and involves saying a lot of difficult goodbyes. So maybe Socrates and Epicurus have convinced you that fearing your own death is absurd. Well, then what about the death of others? Is it equally silly to fear the death of people you love? Probably so, say some philosophers, because what you're fearing isn't actually death. What you're afraid of is being left behind, alone, when a loved one dies. And this is a good place to hear from ancient Chinese Taoist philosopher Zhuangzi. He lived about the same time as Epicurus and believed that there's no reason to fear the death of your loved ones. He asked, "Why would you fear the inevitable? We know that death is going to happen to everyone, and we also know that it's a part of the life cycle. And we don't see any other part of that cycle as being bad. Wouldn't it be silly," he said, "if we mourned the loss of our babies when they became toddlers, or our children when they became teens? We celebrate every other life milestone with birthday parties, bar mitzvahs, and graduations to mark the passage of time and the changes that have come. Sure, your parents might shed some tears when they pack you off to college, but they also knew that that day was going to come when you would move away from them and onto your own life." So death, according to Zhuangzi, is just one more change. Why treat it differently? Instead, he said, you should celebrate the death of a loved one just as you celebrated every other life change they experienced. You should think of their death as a going away party for a grand journey. In his view, mourning can actually seem selfish. When it's time for the people you love to move on, Zhuangzi said, the last thing you should do is hold them closer. Today, we talked about death. We considered philosophical responses from Socrates, Epicurus, and Zhuangzi about whether it's logical to fear your own death or the deaths of your loved ones. And we talked about Thomas Nagel, death, and fear of missing out. This episode of...
I'm sure that some part of that little historical philosophical scenario has touched and come to all of our minds at some point or other. And we have a different perspective on it as we come from our Catholic Christian tradition. But our culture struggle with grief and loss, you can hear it even in the words people use. We say he passed rather than he died. Or we want to celebrate life when a person dies, meaning looking past at what they lived, not looking ahead to what awaits them, that great journey. Growing older is a challenge. We move toward greater wisdom, but also there's more and more a sense of loss of control and the fear that accompanies it. It's not that we resent reality, it's that we resent not being able to control it. And so that need for acceptance and trust is so critical. For years, it was my favorite movie, Harold and Maude. I bet many of you have saw it 30 some years ago when it was out. And if you haven't, put it on your COVID watching list. It wasn't a very conventional film, a love story between a 20-year-old kid and an 80-year-old woman. However, with its wonderful musical score by Cat Stevens and terrific acting by that wonderful actress, Ruth Gordon, it became quite a rage. Harold, the 20-year-old introvert with a gaunt and sinister look, a morbid and depressed spirit, had a fondness for death. The first half of the movie showed him faking various means of suicide to terrorize his mother. Of course, if that woman were your mother, you would have tried to terrorize her too. Domineering and self-serving, she exhibited not an ounce of love or authentic interest in her son's well-being. She was unfazed by Harold's antics that were all designed to shock her. So Harold encounters Maude in the last pew of a church during a funeral. They used to go to funerals frequently. he to feed his morbid ego, she to remind herself of her ultimate destiny. Well, the years have taken their toll and she's as wrinkled as a prune, a little wisp of a woman. However, her spirit is as sprightly as if she were a child of seven. Psst, psst. Some of the worshippers frown and glare at the two. I see you at a lot of funerals, Maud says to Harold as she pushes her way into the pew. You like them too, don't you? Really make you appreciate the mystery of life, the great cycle of birth, life, death, and rebirth. I feel so alive when I come to a funeral. Harold, of course, winces. After the procession leaves the church, they awkwardly try to look pious and somber as the priest passes their pews. They tag along at the end of the funeral cortege. At one funeral, the mourners wind their way into the rainy procession to the cemetery. The camera's aerial view shows the tops of all the black umbrellas, except for the last one, Maud's bright yellow parasol, which she's twirling gaily over her head. Let's watch a clip of that film and listen closely to the dialogue.
Like some licorice?
No, thank you.
You're welcome. Did you know him?
No.
Me neither. I heard he's 80 years old. I'll be 80 next week. Good time to move on, don't you think?
I don't know.
Well, I mean, 75 is too early. But at 85, you're just marking time. You may as well look over the horizon. Never understand this mania for black. Nobody sends black flowers, do they? Black flowers are dead flowers. Who sends dead flowers to a film? It's absurd. What is your name?
Harold. Harold Chasen.
Oh, how do you do? I'm Dame Marjorie Chardin, but you may call me Maud.
How do you do? Nice to meet you.
Well, thank you. I think we're going to be great friends, don't you? Can I give you a lift, Harold?
No, thank you. I have my own car.
Well, I must be off. We shall have to meet again. Tell me, do you dance?
Pardon me?
Do you sing and dance?
No.
No, I thought not.
That woman, she took my car.
Oh, I love that scene. Did you notice the hearse in the background there when they walked out of church? That's Harold's car. And the parade of the marching band, full of life as the coffin is going into the hearse. The contrast between Maud and Harold. Do you sing and dance, Harold? No, I didn't think so. Well, that unlikely twosome portray a delightful contrast in people's approach to death and life. Some, like Harold, grow old before their time, trapped by their circumstances. They can't wait for life to be over and done with. For them, each day is a prison sentence, and death is the release from their torture chamber. Never having found a reason to live beyond the narrow confines of their own needs and desires, life itself becomes a coffin, with the lid quickly closing upon them. Their fate is nothing more than waiting for the burial rites. Others, like Maud, see life as something bigger than themselves. They know that they're here for a good time, not a long time, as a song once sang. And they can take a devil-may-care attitude toward themselves and towards life because They believe that God cares and will always be there for them. They don't dread the end, because for them, it's merely one more adventure, perhaps the greatest adventure. Death is the chance to break out of the limitations of this world. It may lead to extinction, but it may also be a passageway into a richer, a more satisfying experience. In the words of the Apostles' Creed, you and I profess faith in the resurrection of the body and life everlasting. We end most of our liturgical prayers with a sense of eternity, like forever and ever, amen, or world without end, amen. We pray for the dead, inscribe their names into a book, and honor their memory. Yet for all our openness about death and prayer and theology and media and literature, our society still attempts to anesthetize us to its reality, to turn our faces from our own mortality. And so we daily encounter a world that avoids the inevitable, where doctors and nurses, even in a hospital, either refuse or are ill-equipped to discuss death with their patients, where the aged are shelved in the background instead of being recognized as the sources of wisdom and stability that they are. A society which promotes any means, advertising, sales, recreation, cosmetics, to maintain a facade of eternal youth, not a youthful spirit, but a cover-up for the fact that life itself tends towards death. Even our Catholic religion has often succumbed to a mythology about death, with gruesome images from Dante's Inferno, or prayers addressing God as an unrelenting judge. All these blind us to the divine lover and compassionate parent, which scriptures reveal God to be. How then can we as believers face death, and how can our traditional belief in the afterlife and the resurrection help us to live each day more fully? The Word of God has something to offer the heralds and moths among us and within each of us. In our faith, death no longer wields the final blow. It can truly become a passage to a fuller life. G.K. Chesterton once said of our Catholic faith that we believe life is too important to ever be anything but life. That life which is in us survives the tragic breaking apart that comes with death. And if God is with us in that final moment, surely the daily struggles and trials that we face can be lightened when we face them against the background of eternity. St. Paul, in his letter to the Thessalonians, assures us that we are the people who hear the melody of the future. He writes, "Stand firm and hold on to the traditions we taught you. God our Father loved us, and through grace gave us eternal comfort and a good hope." So we can plan for the future, a new job or a new home, our children and grandchildren's security, a more just social order, an end to an epidemic, a spirit of greater change and renewal in society and in the church, a fresh approach to government and leadership, even in the face of our current dismal political landscape. Because we know that God will not fail us. Our hopes will not be dashed. We work with hope for a better tomorrow because we are absolutely convinced that God will fulfill promises and act on our behalf. The Gospels exhort us to be dedicated to living fully in the present. Just as Jesus wouldn't be trapped by the Sadducees who tried to distract themselves from their real issue, you'll recall the story about the woman whose husband died and then married his brother who died and so on. So we not need become confused or enmeshed in the how of life after death. Concern over how things shall be in heaven shouldn't distract us from our present commitments. The belief in the hereafter begins through the love expressed here and now. The bonds of love that we foster and nourish each day, the causes of justice and peace that we uphold, the community of caring hearts that we build here on earth, are the surest and clearest testimony of the glory of a kingdom yet to come. Jesus didn't say, it is the resurrection, or there is the resurrection. He said, I am the resurrection. Our faith in the resurrection is confident love in the person of Jesus Christ and committed union with his body, the church. As Christians, we are hopeful people for this life and for more. By the way, in the movie, Harold finally learned how to live. Maud became his angel of mercy, who showed him what it meant to let go and soak this life for everything it has to offer. Maud died at the end, we all must, and Harold cried to see her go. We all hate to lose a loved one, but his sadness and his broken heart were sure signs that his life was now worth living. Once Maud brought him to life, he was able to put more of himself into each day of living. Maud taught him how to love, and he was able to see in her death a passageway to something more. A beautiful movie and a touching story that echoes our story in Jesus. In his death and resurrection is our passage to new life. As Jesus tells us, our God is the God not of the dead, but of the living. For to God, all are alive. So I want to talk about how we in our Catholic Christian community deal with death, with the rituals of death, how we surround them with prayer. And I want to begin with the prayer of the church for the sick. This is something that I've shared with many of you over the years. And just in the last couple of weeks, shared with several parishioners. The prayer of the church for the sick, the sacrament of the anointing of the sick. And it can take place in an encounter at home, in a hospital, or at a care facility. It begins in a very warm and personal way, excuse me, with a greeting and invitation. An invocation, and there's always scripture in the sacraments, scripture pertinent to that person's life or to God's promise to be with us, especially in our struggles. And then the prayer of intercession and the laying on of hands. The laying on of hands, as you know, takes place in several sacraments. In the ordination of a priest, the bishop lays his hands on the head of the one to be ordained. The sacrament of confirmation, the bishop extends his hands either over the entire group of people to be confirmed, or if it's a smaller group, he lays hands individually on each one of them. And in the anointing of the sick, the celebrant lays hands on the head of the one who's being prayed for. And then the blessing of oil. In Latin, it's olea infirma, means the oil of the sick, one of the three sacramental oils of the church. And then the anointing takes place, and the presider anoints the sick person on the head with the sign of the cross and on each hand. And the prayer that accompanies it says that may God in his great mercy strengthen you, and may the Lord who frees you from all sin save you and raise you up. And then the Lord's Prayer, the Eucharist can be shared, and a blessing. One of the misunderstandings about the sacrament is that it changed, well, it's over 50 years now, but we used to use the term extreme unction, which in Latin, extreme means last or final, and unction means anointing. So it was the final anointing. But that's not what the sacrament originally was intended for. The sacrament was intended for those who were sick in order to get them back on their feet so they could get back to their duties, to their family, to their work, to their ministry. So the sacrament of anointing of the sick is intended for those who are sick or before surgery or those who have grown weak because of age. It's not the ritual for those who are near death. That ritual is the prayer of commendation for the dying. And again, this is a prayer that I prayed in the last few weeks with several parishioners. That commendation for the dying, again, can take place at home or a hospital, oftentimes in a hospital or care facility. It begins with a greeting. It can have a baptismal sharing. There could be the sprinkling of baptismal water and then a penitential rite. There can be individual confession and absolution, then the reading of scripture, a profession of faith, the litany of saints, a prayer of commendation, the Lord's Prayer, and if the person who's dying is capable of receiving communion, then the Eucharist is shared with him, the Eucharist called Viaticum, which translates from Latin, food for the journey, and then a blessing. A person who is dying has never been confirmed may receive the sacrament of confirmation at the hands of the priest. And a priest who is celebrating that commendation prayer with the dying can give absolution to that person. But there is a great deal of pastoral discretion and care that has to be taken at the time when death is near. Oftentimes when I am called to a deathbed to pray that those final prayers, the person who's dying isn't conscious, is not alert, is not unaware of what's happening. But sometimes, as it was last Saturday, the person was very, very much aware, could not speak very well, but was able to receive a little bit of the host for Viaticum, and aware of the prayers, and was surrounded by her family who were praying along with me. One of the loneliest moments for a priest in prayer is being called to a hospital bed where only the dying person is, and the priest is the only one with that person. It's a much fuller experience, if it's possible, to have family or friends surrounding the bed of the one who is dying. And then, as again happened a week ago, where I was called, but the person had already died shortly before I came to the house, then we prayed the appropriate prayers immediately after death. And then the actual prayer of the church for the dead. The word there is stational, because the church sees these moments from dying to death as stations. So that station, first station was when I was at the bedside of the individual, praying the prayers for the dying. And the station when the person had died and I prayed with them. And then there are several stations after death. One is a vigil for the deceased, and that can take place in a mortuary, chapel, or church. And it consists of song and scripture, homily, words of remembrance, intercessory prayer, and a blessing. Now, for a long, long time, we would just call it the rosary. And that was the only prayer that was used at a vigil. Many of you, you know, are old enough to remember when that was the primary prayer at a vigil service. And it can still be incorporated into a vigil, but primarily the vigil is listening to the word of God and keeping vigil, being together with those who are grieving. The vigils we've had at St. Perpetua over the years have been inspiring events. It's an opportunity for people to share words of remembrance and to be able to speak about the individual. Now with our technology, some people have put together a collage of pictures or a PowerPoint presentation that we can show. And the vigil is a more informal opportunity for family and friends to gather together. Then the funeral mass itself. The funeral mass, again, all of you, I'm sure, have been to at least a few, if not, and some of us have been, you know, to many. We receive the coffin or the cremains. Cremains is the word that's used when we have the ashes of the deceased, and we recall their baptism. The coffin is sprinkled, or the cremains is signed with baptismal water. Song, prayer, again, scriptures, homily, intercessory prayer, liturgy of the Eucharist, and the opportunity, not as much as at the vigil service, but for at least one or two family members or friends to offer brief words of remembrance. And then we do something that I think is a very moving and touching part of the ceremony, where the presider offers an incense blessing and incenses the coffin or the cremains. That incense, I think, is twofold. One, the incense that rises up to heaven can be a sign and symbol for us of the soul rising to God, and then also of our prayers ascending to our Heavenly Father for the one who has died. And then a beautiful prayer of final commendation and a song of farewell as we leave the church. And then the final station is at the cemetery. Again, it's a brief ritual, a scripture passage, a blessing of the grave, even though the Catholic cemeteries are considered sacred ground and blessed. I always include a blessing of the grave and the Lord's Prayer and a prayer of committal. And sometimes there are military honors for someone who served in the military at some point in their life. And that can take place either before the church's ritual or after the church's ritual is completed. And then the coffin is lowered into the ground. And families can choose whether or not they want to be present as the coffin is lowered or not. I think it's always a good idea to be present as the cemetery personnel lower the coffin into the ground, because that's that sense of finality. So there were other questions and concerns that, that people asked me about in preparation for looking at this tonight. And these are a few of them, and I'll just have you look at the list, and then I'll remove the screen and just have a chance to talk about these. So what are other religions and cultures' perspective on death? Cremation. Sometimes there's confusion about cremation. A long time ago, it just didn't take place in the Catholic Church, but I'd say for the last 30, 40 years, cremation has become a common way of burial. Someone asked about cemeteries. Is it realistic to think that people will visit a cemetery to see the grave of their loved ones? End-of-life decisions. Our Catholic theology, what's the heaven, hell, and purgatory? Someone asked, will my Buddhist friends be in heaven when I get there? Or will the Presbyterians, or will the atheists be there? Funeral as celebration of life, I want to say a word about that. And then some asked, how do I prepare for my own death, just in case you don't live forever? And then a very challenging thing is how to be with someone who's dying. Many people seem to be at a loss for words, even when close family members are dying. You know, what do I do? What do I say? And Dr. Ira Byock, who is instrumental in the hospice movement, gives us four things to say. So let me close this. And get back to all of you. So if you have questions, I hope you'll pop them in that chat room. I know it's a lot of material. So I want to address some of those individual questions that people asked. Cremation, the word for the ashes is called cremains. And for many years now, the church has permitted cremation. I will say that the church's preference, even if a person is cremated, is that for the funeral mass itself, that the corpse, the body would be there in a coffin, and that cremation would take place after the funeral mass. That, I would say, rarely happens today. And there, then some have asked about what's the difference between a funeral mass and a memorial mass. A funeral mass, it can only be called a funeral mass if the coffin or cremains are present. If for some reason they cannot be present, sometimes it's a matter of time. I'm finding that mortuaries are taking longer to do a cremation, especially now during, you know, this time, and the family might want to have the funeral sooner. Well, it's a memorial mass if the coffin or cremains are not present, because there's no coffin to sprinkle with holy water, no cremains to incense. And so it's can be a beautiful service, the memorial mass, but it wouldn't include those aspects. It would be the scripture readings, liturgy of the word, and liturgy of the Eucharist. Others have asked about a scattering of ashes. The church's practice is burial in the ground or in a mausoleum, in a crypt. One of the reasons for that is our belief in the resurrection of the body or the resurrection of the dead. Now, let me say a little bit about that. In the Hebrew understanding, there's more a sense of the whole person, and that's influenced in the scriptures. But also influenced in the scriptures is the Greek aspect. And the Greek, as philosophers, had a split between body and soul. So when we speak about the resurrection of the body, probably better for us to say the resurrection of the dead, the whole person. The way I like to look at it is that the uniqueness of who you are cannot be destroyed by death. That in God's eyes, you will always be you, not some amorphous, floating particle in the universe, but rather the unique person that each one of us is, created by God. So when we say we believe in the resurrection of the dead, that means that the person that each one of us is in the eyes of God is never lost. And that in that final, you know, glorious resurrection, we will be who we are. If you look at the gospel story about Lazarus, or about the widow's son that Jesus rose, they were taking him into the funeral procession, and Jesus touched his bier, and he was raised from the dead. That's not resurrection, that's resuscitation. Because Lazarus and all the others that Jesus raised, they will die again. So it's not resurrection, it's resuscitation, which the miracle that shows that Jesus had power over death. But what we look forward to is Jesus' resurrection. And those are words like exaltation, glorification, ascension, seated at the right hand. So in our resurrection, we won't be disembodied souls or revivified corpses, but we will have a new and glorious life. How do you describe that? Artists have been trying for thousands of years, haven't they? And some do a better job at it than others. But it's hard to imagine. What is that new and glorious life? So that the scattering of the ashes again. Now, people have asked about that, and they said they're going to do it. And all I said was, just don't tell me. It's your loved one. I can only tell you what the church's tradition is and so on. But people have had, you know, a favorite place that they vacation every summer at their cottage or, you know, so on. As I say, I can only give you what, you know, the church's theology and spirituality is about it. And the truth be told, when we leave this life, when we take that final breath, we are already entering into a different realm. The things that we do here on earth, they are for us. They're not for the person that has gone. They are already in the arms of God, being cared for and loved. Cemeteries themselves. You know what happens when there is an accident on a highway and someone is killed, do you notice the shrines that are built come within hours? Or any of the killings that we've seen in the recent racial strife that we've had? What happens at the site where that death took place? Within hours, there are candles and roses and teddy bears and notes and pictures and posters. It's the human need to concretize and to have a physical place to put us in touch with that life that was lost. And that's just what cemeteries are. Yeah. I go to Queen of Heaven Cemetery a lot over in the past 22 years. It's been hundreds of times that I've been there. Each time I drive into the cemetery, I'm shocked to see the number of graves that have flowers on them. Most of them now are artificial because there are too many deer around who love to graze on the flowers that people, you know, put on their loved ones. So they've taken to putting artificial flowers on. But I'm amazed, which tells me that people do come to the cemetery and commune with their loved ones who have died. Every time I drive out of the cemetery, I go past the section where Father Frank Hodek is buried. And I always stop for a moment and have a chat with him. And close to him is buried Father Declan Dean. And I have a chat with him as I drive past. And the father of a friend of mine is close by. They're all in the same neighborhood. They're all buddies in the hood together. So I think cemeteries have always been seen as sacred places and sacred ground. Just a couple of weeks ago, a parishioner whose wife died a year ago, the tombstone had only recently been put in place. And he asked me to come and we blessed the tombstone and said a prayer together with him and his daughter and myself. And he's told me how regularly he visits her at the cemetery. So they are, you know, sacred places for us. The questions of heaven, hell, and purgatory are probably too detailed to go into in our short time, but just a word about purgatory. That was such a bugaboo and a real blockade between us and Protestants. What is that all about? We know that we can't think of heaven, hell, and purgatory as places. Once we leave this life, time and space are no more for us. We have this new life, which is indescribable, but they're not places. We can say, oh, heaven's up, hell's down. And that's for us because that's all we can think of. We can only think in our categories. But in those eternal categories, there is no such thing as time or place. So all those prayers I said as a kid to get, you know, 400 days indulgence off somebody in purgatory, you know, well, I still said the prayers. I hope they were, you know, ascended to God. But in terms of the theology that would give it, you know, like a prison sentence time, we can't use that any longer. It's simply inappropriate. But the word for me that's better is purgation. So if you're going to a wedding reception, you know, you might get a haircut, a style. You might get a new dress or a new suit. You're at least going to take a shower and shave and clean yourself up before you make your appearance there. If you didn't, somebody's going to wonder, you know. There's a purgation that has, if we are going to in eternity encounter God who is all good, God who is all loving, God who is all in all, then wouldn't we want to be well prepared to do that, to let go of whatever has been in our past or in our life and purge ourselves of that in order to be prepared to enter into that eternity, that moment of pure bliss, of exquisiteness, of loving union with God. So for me, that's how I've understood, you know, purgatory, not as a place, not as a jail sentence, not as a place of suffering, but rather a place of purgation where the soul is cleansed, purified in order to make that encounter with God. I want to, there's a few other things that I think are really critical. One is how to be with someone who's dying. How do you talk to a person? What do you say? And and the other thing is those end of life issues. Those are so difficult for a family. Even with the hospice care, which is so excellent, we never know when that final moment is going to come. And sometimes families can be so stressed out. Have we done enough? Are we doing the right thing? Should we do this surgery for mom or for dad? So I'm going to use next week to talk about that, to talk about those end of life issues. The church teaches us that we do not have to take extraordinary means to preserve life. And that's such an important lesson for us to learn, and a teaching of the church that we need to keep in mind. We are not morally obligated to take extraordinary means to preserve life. So next week, I want to flesh that out and look at, well, what are extraordinary means? Hydration, nutrition, and look at the morals and ethics of that. And as I say, that would take a longer time. Someone asked if you can commingle the cremains in an ossuary. I presume you mean of, you know, say a husband and wife and so on. Again, based on what I said earlier about the uniqueness of the individual, I think the church's, you know, perspective would be no, you know, that doesn't kind of adhere to that notion of the uniqueness of the individual. And then Terry, you wanted to say something about hospice care. So go on.
If you're going to be talking about this, maybe it's more appropriate for next week. But one thing I did want to say is that hospice is used often at the last minute, and people really don't take advantage of it the way they should. There are experts that can come to your home and evaluate if a person is eligible or not, and so that family doesn't have to make those decisions. There's people that can help them along, and they were just so wonderful when we used hospice for my mother. And then I worked in hospice later also, and I found that oftentimes people just do not contact them early enough to get all the benefit. And they can be so good to take care of these physical issues, to give you time to work on the spiritual and all the other things that are necessary. So, that's all I wanted to say.
Well, thank you, Terry. I think so many of us could give testimony to hospice caregivers. They are angels. I call them angels of mercy. Mm-hmm. And you're right. They can bring relief to a family who is stressed out, who many for the first time facing someone who's dying in the family. And that's why I wanted to extend this to next week as well, because I think those are critical things. The other thing that people seem not to be as aware of before hospice care is palliative care. And palliative care is, you can begin palliative care even before hospice care. And it's a way of kind of moving into that and preparing. And we need more and more to be less and less afraid of those words of hospice care and palliative care. because they give relief to families and they bring peace to the individual. Especially when it comes to relieving that person of pain. So that will be, as I said, for next week. And I want to close. One of the questions that someone said is, how do I prepare myself, you know, for dying? I want to show a video that I've been wanting to show for a while. You know, earlier this summer, there was a little boy in Burton Valley that died in an accident. He was 10 years old. His name is Leo. And he was with three buddies of his. They were all at Burton School, and they were starting this year in Stanley Elementary. And his three buddies were all members of St. Perpetua. Their family were all parishioners. And Leo, coming down of pretty steep hill, I made a turn. I don't know the details, but he turned into a truck, and the force, the impact, was so strong that he died from that. He's got a little sister and his parents, and his dad. And immediately a shrine went up at the corner of two streets in Burton Valley. Perhaps some of you saw it or live in that area. And it was posters and teddy bears and candles and flowers and notes and love notes from his friends and so on. His dad put a little video, a clip together to honor his son. And if anyone wants to know how to live, Leo can show the way. Christoph, do you have me on screen with the?
I see your screen, yes.
Okay. Here's Leo. So if you want to know how to prepare for your own death, his parents had a little motto. They started a fund, a scholarship fund in his memory, called Live Like Leo. If in 10 years, one of God's creatures could pack that much energy, charm, beauty, and friendship from what his friends say. He lived in several parts of the world. He was multicultural. He broke boundaries. He accepted everyone. So live like Leo, whether God gives you 10 years or 100 years. And your life will be more than worthwhile. And you'll have a wonderful home with the Lord. Have a peaceful night.
Father John?
Yes.
You know, for those of us who have lived longer than this lovely young person, I have over the years worked with some friends who were willing to engage the process of doing what I can only describe as legacy work. That includes a whole variety of things that can be very helpful for your own self in both coming to terms with your own life and making things easier for those who come after to deal with things, but also, you know, it includes, you know, planning, you know, your own funeral in light of the folks that are, you know, coming after you, especially if they do not share your own faith tradition. But my experience has been, it's not a depressing thing at all to do, but it has a way of drawing things together, even in terms of your own spiritual journey at whatever point you are when you start this work. But it is a thing that is well worth doing. And, you know, I'd happily talk about it at some point, but.
And if there's contact information about it, and we'll include some of the resources. Someone has asked, and I'll take just one more minute. I mentioned Dr. Ira Byock, and if you listen to podcasts, Krista Tippett has an interview with Dr. Byock, which is very powerful. So his four things to say that a person who's dying needs to hear: please forgive me. I forgive you. Thank you. And I love you. With those who are closest to us, we all carry baggage. We all carry the memory of a hurt. We all carry it can be a short time or a long-term antagonism or issue. And you want to leave this world freed of that. Please forgive me. I forgive you. The person who's dying doesn't want to be burdened with thoughts that there's unfinished business for them, that something they might have said or done would have been, you know, a burden to you. So I forgive you. Thank you. Thank you for all that you are, all that you've given me, all that you've meant to me. And I love you. Let's not leave those things for the end of life. Those should be the things that are crossing our lips every day, and our minds and our hearts. Good night, everybody.
Good night.